everyone, and welcome to Creative Edge Writers Showcase. I'm your host, Christie Stratos, author of Anatomy of a Darkened Heart and Lock and Key, and the owner of my own editing company at proofpositivepro.com. This show is part of the Authors on the Air Global Radio Network, and tonight we have an international, multi-award-winning, best-selling science fiction author, Robert J. Sawyer, with us. So thank you so much for being here.
It's my pleasure, Christine. Thank you for having me.
For those of our listeners who aren't familiar with your work, can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure. I'm a Hugo and Nebula award-winning science fiction writer based in Toronto, Canada. I have 23 novels under my belt, all from major New York publishers, the best known of which is probably Flash Forward, which was the basis for the ABC TV series of the same name, starring Joseph Fiennes and John Cho.
That's great. I was really amazed when I was going through everything you've done. I knew some of what you had done. And then when I was seeing more about your TV and your script writing and things like that, it was really exciting to get to interview you.
Well, I'm delighted. It's a pleasure to be here.
Thank you. So how did you actually start out being a writer? Were you a full-time novelist like right off the bat, or did you start with a full-time job and then transition into being a novelist full-time?
So I've been a full-time writer since I was 23 years old, but a full-time novelist only since my early 30s. I spent that first decade making my living doing nonfiction. I did press releases and newsletters and speeches for corporations and all three levels of government, municipal, provincial here in Canada, and federal, lots and lots of newspaper and magazine journalism, mostly in the high-tech area. This was the 1980s, so the notion of personal computers revolutionizing business was actually something you could make a living writing about instead of being just the backdrop of everybody's life. And I was selling short stories at the blistering pace of about one a year during the 80s, in and around making a living as a journalist and as a corporate communications writer. But the eye was always on the prize. All of that other stuff was just so that I could practice my craft as a writer, make a living and be self-employed, but working towards being a full-time novelist. My first novel came out in 1990, and about 2 years later, I transitioned completely to doing nothing but writing science fiction novels.
That must have felt amazing.
It was wonderful. It was exactly what I wanted to do with my life. And I'm, you know, my parents were both economists. I was brought up with a sort of fiscal conservatism, even though I have a liberal outlook. And I knew that the vast majority of people who set out to be writers don't make a living doing it. They just, it's a reality. Most people don't get to make a living being a writer. So I was very, very grateful, in the best atheistic sense. I felt fortunate that a lot of good luck had come my way. And I'm always cognizant of that. I never say, you know, oh, well, you know, it was all my hard work. Yes, I worked hard, but I know lots of other people who worked very hard too and didn't get some of the breaks that I got. I'm very cognizant of the fact that you can bring to the table the work ethic, you can bring to the table whatever talent genetics might have dealt you, but you also have to hope that some lucky breaks, that some significant people take note of your work early on, that you get, you know, a hand up, which is why I'm always there to give somebody else a hand up coming up behind me.
That's great. And actually, speaking of that, I did see on your website, there was a post from 2010 I wanted to ask you about. It asked the question of whether the full-time novelist days are numbered. And I thought that was really interesting because some people were, you know, you wrote openly about this both sides, and yeah, some people disagreed and thought that writers would have to, instead of surviving on their writing, they'd have to survive on things like conferences, appearances, keynote speeches, stuff like that.
Right.
But you did note that you have been asked by multiple events to do those things for free. They don't even cover your costs necessarily.
Yeah.
And now it was a really interesting article or blog post. And now that it's 8 years after that blog post, I wondered if you still felt the same way.
Wow, tempus fugit. I had not been conscious of the fact that 8 years had passed since I wrote that. So I am very lucky. I'm a science fiction writer, and that means that I can spin my expertise to also presenting myself as a futurist. And I do a lot of keynote addresses. The difference between a science fiction writer and a futurist is an order of magnitude in what you can charge for giving a talk. You're lucky if you get, you know, in Canada, we have a National Arts Council, Canada Council for the Arts. They have a set rate of $250 if you have a library to have you in to do a reading, and the government will give you a kickback. I understand it's even harder in the States to get paid to do a reading. Well, I charge between $5,000 and $15,000 to give a keynote address. And I just came back from Miami, where I was doing one for Nokia, actually. So certainly that is a supplement to my income. But people looked, when I wrote that article, people were saying, well, you know, lots of bands don't make any money off of the actual software they produce. They don't make money off of selling their songs to individual listeners. They make it off of concerts. They make it off of t-shirts. They make it off of what have you. The cult of personality has never been that great with authors. And indeed, there's a huge difference in personality between your average author, who is a bit of a recluse and usually, you know, an introvert, and your average rock star, who by definition is a performer and is out there. So we don't come to the table with the same skill set where we can say, okay, put me on tour, charge people, you know, $75 a ticket to come fill an auditorium and $150 a ticket and watch me. And at the end, they'll line up for hours to get my autograph. That's not going to happen. Most authors have to make their living selling their words. I certainly supplement and leverage the fact that my particular genre can be presented as an area of expertise, rational extrapolation of where we're going in science and technology, in a way a fantasy author or a horror author or a mystery author or a romance author can't do that. And very few of them manage to get any kind of appreciable speaking fee. So again, part of that is who I happen to be. Part of that is luck that I chose, with never intending to require a secondary source of income. I chose a genre that lent itself to a certain amount of consulting and a certain amount of keynote speaking. And certainly I'm not alone in doing it. David Brin, a great colleague of mine, science fiction writer, does a lot of this same sort of keynote speaking and consulting all over the world as I do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And when I was looking at your page on your website about the speaking that you do, you actually are able to tailor your speaking to very, very different things. And I think, I'm not sure if it's motivational, but I know that you actually will go to some companies and speak. And I think that that's really an outstanding quality that you have. Not everyone would probably be able to do that. That's pretty cool.
Well, you know, it's funny because authors, I said a moment ago, authors are not rock stars, right? My friend Neil Gaiman sort of set out to become the rock star of the horror field. And he knew what he was doing. He adopted a persona, a leather jacket, a look. You know, he knew how to package himself, and he had the good looks and the effervescent personality to do it. But many authors don't have those skills, but they also studiously refuse to get those skills. One of the most excruciating things that I have to do periodically is give a reading at a science fiction convention or at a library with other writers. I enjoy doing it myself because I'm a good entertainer. I've worked hard to practice my craft so that I can give a dramatic, dynamic reading with different voices and accents and hit the emphasis. So many of our colleagues, Christine, never practice their public reading skills. And so you end up with two boat anchors and you on the dais, and the other two read with their face down into their pages, not ever looking up, in a monotone, and always go over their allotted time. And it's pure living hell for the other author and for the audience. So I say, yes, I've been lucky, but I've also realized where I had skills and where I did not have skills. And if you don't have skills as a public speaker, then go get some. Join Toastmasters. Take a course. Take every opportunity you can to do a public reading, because, of course, you know, you'd like to think you get better with practice at anything you do, so that when the big opportunity comes, you can actually do it.
That's really great advice. I myself am guilty of that, even just in a reading, you know, to a camera. And I like to, in my head, it's more dynamic than I normally speak. But when you hear it played back and you watch yourself, it's really not the same as a dynamic speaker. And even when you're speaking here, it's funny because I was thinking as you were speaking, you know, you would be good at audiobooks, actually, because you modulate your voice and there's a lot of interest in the way you present. Have you ever done an audiobook by chance?
I have done the introductions for several of my audiobooks and for audiobooks by other authors, but for Frederick Pohl and Arthur C. Clarke for Audible. They asked me to write an original introduction to some of their novels and record it myself. I do have a nice voice. I know a lot of people tell me that. I'm glad to hear it, of course, but it is not where my passion or my real talent lies. So, you know, to get, now one of my books runs about 100,000 words. To be read with appropriate Kirk Shatner dramatic pauses and so forth, it's about 11 hours of finished recording. Now, I'm not a pro, so I would need about a 4-to-1 ratio in the studio with the mic to get that 11 hours. In other words, I need a full 40-hour week taken out of my life to record an audiobook. I have 23 audiobooks. Now, all of my novels, all 23, are available as audiobooks. Each one of those took a week. We're talking 6 months of productive life that would have gone into me doing that, compared to now the experts that they have do it. And every one of them has had a great narrator. And one of mine, Calculating God, won the Audi Award from the Audible Publishers Association for the best science fiction or fantasy audiobook of the year, which certainly had to do with my book, but also had to do with Jim Davis's wonderful reading of my book. I can't afford to take the time for what it pays through audiobook narration. I'm better rewarded spending that 6 months of my career working on, you know, writing another book than narrating the existing ones. I enjoy listening to audiobooks, and I'm delighted with all the audiobooks that have been produced. But I also know that I have a finite amount of time in the world, and I've chosen wisely how to spend it.
Yeah, that's a really good point. I know some indie authors will do that because they either, you know, you can't pay for somebody right. or whatever like that. But if you could afford it, what you're saying about time makes an awful lot of sense. You do have to manage your time very carefully.
Yeah. And indie authorship has its pluses and its minuses. One of the minuses is you normally do have to pay to package your own audiobook. One of the pluses of being with a major publisher is, of course, Audible pays me in advance for the audio rights, and they bear all of the production costs, which means the fee for the narrator, the fee for the producer, all the studio time, all of that is paid for by somebody else, and they give me money, right? So there's a trade-off there. Now, that said, we were talking a few minutes ago about whether or not the day of the full-time freelance writer is over, freelance novelist is over. When I started in this industry in 1990, it was very easy to say to a publisher, my first publisher was Warner, now Hachette, one of the big five. And I've been with, you know, with Macmillan, and I've been with Penguin, my current publisher, and so forth, HarperCollins. Very easy to say to them, oh yeah, you can have the rights to my book, but I'm going to keep the audiobook rights. And they thought, those are worthless anyways. Nobody does audiobooks. They're all on cassette tapes, right? To do a 10-hour, 11-hour audiobook on cassette tapes, they'd have to sell it for $80 for the set of 8 cassettes. Nobody's going to buy it. Nobody cared. Now, thanks to Audible, it's a very vigorous market. So we're just about to go out to my publisher with a new proposal. And I know what they're going to say. They're going to say, okay, great. Absolutely. Love to have this. But we got to have the audiobook rights this time. We got to keep that revenue stream. Now, of course, they would split it with me. You don't, when you give up a revenue stream, you give up control of it. They would take half the money and I would get half. But I used to get all of it, right? Mm-hmm. So we're going to have a fight. We're going to have a tussle over that and saying, well, you know, here's my royalty statements from Audible. These things are actually worth real money. You can't have that right without compensating me for that right. So. Yeah. But the publishers are always grabbing more and more. Every year, they're looking for a wider territory instead of just the United States and Canada. Then they wanted world English. Now they want all world rights in all languages. They used to just want print. Now, of course, they want print and digital, e-publishing. And now they want audio rights, too. They used to pay advances, my first novel, half when I signed the contract, half when I handed in the manuscript. Penguin standard now is 4 parts. A quarter on signing, a quarter when you handed the manuscript, a quarter when it comes out in hardback, a quarter a year later in paperback. Nobody makes a living. Nobody can make a living when they're being paid. That means I finish the novel. Let's say I finish a novel today, 2018. The paperback would be out in 2020, 2 years from now. I'm being paid for work that I finished today. Nobody can make a living on that kind of cash flow basis.
No, of course not. And actually, I did see that you have a Patreon.
I do.
Along
fairly
those lines.
New, a couple of months now, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And on there, you had said that you are not quite as interested anymore in seeking a publishing contract with a traditional publisher because of the way the industry has changed, just as you're saying.
Right. When I started, they brought so much to the table. There were thousands and thousands of independent bookstores in North America. And the only way people read books was on paper, talking 1990, my first book. There was no way that I could self-publish, or anybody could practically self-publish a novel back then. And the publisher said, oh, we'll service those thousands upon thousands of accounts, and we'll get your book into stores all across, and blah, blah, blah. And that was great. But those thousands and thousands of accounts have dwindled to a handful of accounts, of which the biggest are obviously Amazon and Barnes & Noble. And so there are only a couple of major accounts to be serviced. They used to do some promotion, some advertising, some book touring. Almost all of that has disappeared. And they said, oh, you author, you go after you finish your day of hard writing, you go and hit social media for 6 hours and drum up interest. You do that as well. And we want your audiobooks. And we want a piece of the action in film and TV. And. So, yeah, they're bringing a lot less to the table each time, and making it the payout schedule so ridiculously long that an author like myself, who does have alternatives, who has an audience already, certainly is considering whether to exercise those alternatives.
Sure. And it sounds like a really good idea. And I think I have noticed that you do have a couple of self-published books. Am I right?
I have a bunch of my backlist out self-published now. So this is the big thing. This is, you know, whenever, let's say, I'm a big Star Trek fan. I don't know if you can see here, but I've got, here's a little Starship Enterprise. I got all kinds of stuff back here. That's Star Trek, right? So the guy who made this is made actually by Eagle Moss in the UK. It's a little Enterprise model. They have a license that has a set number of years to it. And when that license expires, on the day it expires, they can no longer sell that. All intellectual property is sold between corporations, licensed between corporations, on a basis of expiring contracts. Authors are the only ones in the intellectual property universe who say, okay, I'll give you a contract that has no fixed expiration date to publish my book. You decide when and if I ever get the rights back. And of course, when we started, again, in my case, 1990, but this goes back to the dawn of publishing, it was an expensive thing to do a new printing of a book. So my first novel was not a success, did not have a second printing. And when it came time, we said, you know, you've sold out the first printing, it's gone. Are you going to print more? And they looked at their balance sheet and said, well, you know, it's tens of thousands of dollars to go back to press. No. We'll give you back the rights. These days, the publisher says, well, you know, you're right. We're not ever going to print it again, but it is available for print on demand via Amazon. So if anybody ever wants it, it is technically in print and you never get your rights back. It's absolutely horrendous. Absolutely horrendous. And it is to the great blame of all writers groups, Mystery Writers of America, Science Fiction Fantasy Writers of America, Horror Writers, Romance Writers, the Authors Guild, every group that's ever existed has been way too slow off the mark of saying to publishers, hey, you got to license property the way Disney does, the way Paramount does, the way Lucasfilm, which is now Disney, of course, says, well, everything will ultimately be Disney, right? Flash forward, my TV series was Disney at the highest level of ownership. So, we live under an economic model that's based on the fact that books go out of print, and they just don't anymore, not in a meaningful sense. And so we're giving up our rights. We try to claw them back. Now, I've managed to claw back 6 of my 23 from the original publishers. They're all out there, available in my own editions, which means that I make all the money except for the skim, the 30% skim that Amazon or Kobo or iBooks or Nook takes off the top. 70% is what I make if you buy one of my old titles from me. 17.5%, that is 25% of net, is what I make if you buy one of my old titles from Tor, who was my publisher for a decade. And that just is not fair in any way, shape, or form. That Tor holds on to the rights, makes almost no sales of the books. And then when they do happen to make a sale, usually because I've done some social media promotion that mentioned an older title, that they benefit three times as much as I do off of each sale.
Yeah, that doesn't come across too well. It doesn't seem like a really great deal anymore.
It's no longer a partnership. It's a serfdom. Yeah. And I don't mean to single out any particular publisher, because all five of the big five, all five of the remaining big publishers, Macmillan, Penguin Random House, HarperCollins, Hachette, and Simon & Schuster, they're the only five big publishing conglomerates left, and all of them are equally rapacious towards their authors now. They found they couldn't make money from Amazon, so they make money from us by clawing back from the creators without whom they would not exist. Authors are the sine qua non, the without which nothing of the publishing industry, and yet we get treated like the most disposable of commodities.
Yeah, and it's really such a shame. And as you say, you know, they would have nothing. They wouldn't be an industry if it was not for writers, of course. But script writing must be a different thing, I would assume. And you've done a fair amount of that, some of it for, as you said before, script writing your own actual novel.
Sure. I'm a member of the Writers Guild of America and the Writers Guild of Canada. And the huge difference is these are actual unions, as opposed to Science Fiction and Fantasy Writers of America or Mystery Writers of America, what have you, which are quote-unquote professional associations. So a union has bargaining power. A union can go on strike. The Writers Guild of America famously did go on strike to strike for compensation for use on new media, on DVD, on streaming digital, and so forth. And solidarity is how you get a change in the industry. So yes, whenever I've worked under a Writers Guild contract, either the Canadian one or the American one, I've been well compensated. The payment has come on time. There's somebody who will go chasing after the money for me if it's late. Publishers are notoriously late in cutting checks, because what are you going to do? You're just one guy, right? You can't go and beat up a publishing company, but the Writers Guild of America can beat up ABC if they have to. And that solidarity, the lone wolf mentality of most publishers, most authors, forgive me, has worked against our best interests, for sure. I love doing script writing for the money, but I got to say, creatively, overall, there's nothing that beats having a novel, which is why even famous script writers will turn around and write a novel. David Goyer, who was our showrunner on Flash Forward, very well-regarded script writer. He and Michael Cassett, another script writer who works on Z Nation right now, they did a lovely series of books for my publisher. In fact, I helped introduce them to the editor. And it's the pinnacle of achievement is when you've controlled everything and nobody, you know, can say, well, we can't afford that, or that actor is sick this week, or you have to rewrite it because it's raining today. You know, you're God of the universe in a novel in a way you never can be on a collaborative TV production.
Yeah, those are really good points. And actually, you mentioned something that made me remember that I believe it says on your website that you are a dual citizen of America and Canada. How has that helped your career?
Oh, number one was when Flash Forward sold to ABC. I said, I'm going to come down and be part of the show. And he said, well, you know, immigration, green card. No. Here's my U.S. passport. Oh, okay. No problem. I have a U.S. passport and a Canadian one, U.S. social insurance number, U.S. social security number, Canadian social insurance number. Have to file tax returns with both agencies, but there are ways to avoid being doubly taxed, amongst which are the fact that I'm incorporated in Canada. But it lets me come and work anywhere I want in North America, which is a wonderful thing. I tell my friends in Britain that they're out of their mind to be withdrawing from the European Union, because every Brit right now can work anywhere in the EU. And that disappears like that. Boom. Suddenly you can't. It is I have friends who would kill here in Toronto to be able to do what I do periodically, which is go down to Los Angeles and work on a TV project. Because they can't get the green card, they can't get the immigration, they can't get the authorization. So yeah, absolutely. It's been probably the greatest gift that my mixed parentage of an American mother and Canadian father ended up giving me.
Yeah, that is so fabulous. And I would also love that, actually. So I also wanted to ask you about your awards. You are a Hugo Award winner. You are a
True.
Nebula Award winner. You have won many other awards. And you've even won awards in other countries, I believe in China, Japan, other countries. And
France,
so
Spain, yeah.
France, Spain, yeah.
Other
So
places.
you've also been a finalist for many awards as well, even if you didn't win. So I wanted to ask you, what do you think it is? What is it about your writing that you think puts you in the running time and time again for some of these huge sci-fi awards?
Sure. The number one thing is theme. Books that are about something, books that are issue-oriented, books that tackle, even if they don't succeed in really coming up with a definitive response to an issue, but at least try to be something more than just escapism, just mindless entertainment. Not only do they attract award attention all the time, you're right, I've won over 50 awards. I've been nominated for over 150 awards for my fiction over the years. Not only does it attract that, but it also is the only thing that can get a novelist media attention, mainstream media attention. You can't get media attention saying, well, I've written this story, see, about this guy, see, and he's on a quest, see, and his girlfriend wants this, but he wants, nobody cares. Not even your mother. Nobody, nobody. So I'm writing a story about why it is people mindlessly follow authoritarian leaders. Oh my God, well, isn't that what's happening in some places in the world right now? Isn't it what happened in Nazi Germany? Why is it that people who obviously are intelligent and obviously seem to be moral individuals will suddenly fall in line and say, I'm just following orders and do the most reprehensible things? Well, you can see how you very easily get media interviews, whether it's a novel or whether it's a nonfiction work, if it's got a theme and you've done the research so you know what you're talking about.
That makes a lot of sense to me, and I think that a lot of authors actually feel afraid to bring up some kind of political issue or anything like that because of the political climate today.
You
So would
know,
you?
see, this is the thing. You're absolutely right. But every beginning author thinks the whole world is going to want to read their books. The answer is no. I'm a successful author. I'm economically successful, awards. Very narrow segment of the reading public wants to read my books. That very narrow segment, the liberally inclined, technologically positive, optimistic thinker about the future who's got a philosophical bent, enjoys bad puns, and has a fondness for pop culture. That's my reader. I cater to them. And if I alienate all these other people, what difference does it make? They weren't going to be my readers anyway. My job is to give the best books I can to the people who like what it is that I write and who I am, what I care about, what I'm passionate about as a person. You set out trying to please everybody and you end up with pablum. You are just bland, 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 bland. You have to, in this, yes, it's a polarized world. It's polarized because people are passionate on the left and on the right. It doesn't matter where you are, you're passionate in your beliefs. Well, who wants to read fiction about people who are not passionate, who are bland and afraid to say they're pro-gun or anti-gun or pro-life or pro-choice? Real people, every single person you know has an opinion on whether or not God exists, on whether or not Donald Trump is a good president, on whether or not abortion is right or wrong, or whether or not American or Soviet or Canadian foreign policy is a boon or a detriment to world peace. Every person you know has an opinion. And you pull open a book, and the people in the pages aren't supposed to have opinions. That's the very definition of cardboard characters.
Very true. And that is the one of the most important things to avoid, of course, because nobody can relate to that.
That's right. Real people are passionate and they disagree. Now, if you the thing that's dangerous is if you have a whole bunch of characters who have intelligent, rational views on one side and then a bunch of straw men and women on the other side who you just make up as idiots so you can knock them down. You have to learn to understand why it is that somebody else who also has read a lot of books, who also has given a lot of thought to things, who's also had a lot of life experience came up with a completely different worldview than you or your character on one side of the equation might have. And when you get into that and say, okay, why on earth would you have that viewpoint? Then you start to be able to write real meaningful dialogue between characters that makes people, hopefully on both sides of whatever debate you happen to be touching on, think.
Yeah, that is really great advice. And since we're talking about variety, I did want to ask you about the different subgenres you've written of sci-fi and different genres in general. Yes. So just to name a few, I know you've written noir crime, hard science fiction, you have a Sherlock Holmes short story out there, that's alien right. invasion, time travel. So is there
adventure,
history? Yeah, even more.
It's the beauty of it, because in science fiction, people say, well, isn't that a very narrow category? No, it is the broadest possible category. All of space, all of time, all forms of life. And what I do that people respond to seems to work regardless of what other genre I marry it with. So my novel Rollback, we just did a deal with Sony Pictures Television to have a TV adaptation of it, is a science fiction romance. My novel Red Planet Blues, which is also in development in Los Angeles, science fiction noir detective novel. You can do almost anything under the rubric of thinking about the future. And I find that the readership is very interested in following me wherever I go. Whereas if I'd started out as a mystery novelist, I might well have 23 novels, the same number I do have, but they would be 23 different cases of the same detective. That would have been purgatory for me. It would have driven me nuts to have to keep doing the same thing over and over and over again.
I can imagine. Yeah. And it's interesting that you say that about science fiction, because I had also thought, well, I can't imagine mixing some of these things together, and yet you do. So I think that's really fascinating, and you seem to really have no problem just going back and forth between these different subgenres.
Any writer, no matter what genre you write, you need to read widely, right? I couldn't write a noir novel if I hadn't read a lot of noir novels. I couldn't have written a romance if I hadn't read a fair bit of a romance. I couldn't write a classically structured mystery novel like my novel Illegal Alien if I hadn't read a lot of mystery. So I always say, you know, when I'm teaching writing, the first question I ask the class is, what are you reading now? Astonishingly, there'll be people who say nothing. They're doomed to fail, right? They fantasize about what it must be like to be a writer, but they don't, if you're not a compulsive reader, you're never going to become a writer. And then the second question I ask, what are you reading out of your genre? What nonfiction are you reading? And what are you reading that isn't, if you're a science fiction writer, what are you reading that isn't science fiction at all? How are you keeping sure that you're not just doing okay work within a narrow genre, but world-class work regardless of the genre, that the quality of the writing, of the characterization, of the thematic treatment, of the dialogue, of the suspense, of the humor, of all the multifaceted and wondrous things that go into making a novel are good by the standards of any reader, not just, yeah, you know, science fiction is not known for characterization, and that character kind of sort of was a little bit well-rounded, so we give him a gold star. Forget that. You want people who've never read a science fiction novel to say, I cried when that character faced that tragedy. That's when you know you're a writer.
Absolutely. And I know that on your website, I have seen some great quotes from testimonials and things like that about your writing, people being able to read science fiction, even if they're not that into it themselves. Normally, yes. You're able to simplify things to a degree that they're intelligent, of course, but they're still understandable to everyone.
That's right. And most people who say they don't read science fiction, when you push them on it, you say, or read or watch science fiction. Well, did you read The Handmaid's Tale? Oh, yeah, but that's not science fiction. Well, yes, it is. 1984. Well, you know, it was written in 1948, so it was about the future. Kind of science fiction, right? Westworld. Oh, I love Westworld on HBO, right? But it's not science. It's all about robots. What else could it possibly be but science fiction? And you find that so many people, and I blame George Lucas for this, have made a space opera, very narrow, escapist form of science fiction, action, adventure, entertainment, and think that that's all that the genre has to offer. And it's really unfortunate because the genre is much, much wider in its purview than really, as I mentioned earlier, than any other genre that a commercial fiction writer could be working in.
Well, before we sign off here, I wanted to ask, where are you going next with your writing?
Well, in terms of what I'm writing, And this is always good advice for readers. Ask yourself how you're going to get on TV when your book comes out. I'm writing an alternate history of the Manhattan Project. I'm aiming for it coming out in just about 2 years from right now. We're talking in June of 2018. Well, July of 2020 is the 75th anniversary of the Trinity Test, world's first atomic bomb. August of 2020, 75th anniversary of the destruction of Hiroshima and Nagasaki by atomic weapons, and of course, the end of World War II. I'm doing an alternate history about the scientists who developed the atomic bomb for that 75th anniversary year. You can bet that every radio and TV station in the world is going to be looking for somebody they can have on to talk about it. So not only is that what I'm writing, but I'm writing it very specifically to have it ready so that it can come out at the peak possible time for promotion. Now, whether it'll come out with one of my traditional publishers or whether it'll be my first front list new title that I publish myself depends entirely on what kind of offers are made in the next few weeks. Actually, we'll be taking this out. And whether I feel that the clawback that everybody is trying to do these days in big publishing is sufficiently small that I can accept it, and that the payout is sufficiently large.
Of course, yeah. And that actually sums up so much of what we've been talking about here today. And obviously you are taking your own advice. So that is really great to hear. We've been talking with Robert J. Sawyer. Thank you so much for being here.
An absolute pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us on this first episode of Creative Edge Writers Showcase. We will be back June 21st at 9 p.m. Eastern Time with young adult author Susie Vidori. And in the meantime, you can look up our show on Facebook for updates. Thank you for joining us.